Right, we have a receipt number and product ID, and we don't have any product category ID here. Okay, so product ID and then price, quantity, discount, total, line total, and the data transaction. So with this, we are going to build some reports. Okay. So before starting this sales database report, so let us see yesterday's report. That is actually we have built one employee database. From the employee database, we have created one report that is very simple report, tabular report. It is very static, right? So it is just presenting the information. So presenting information of all the people, right? All the employees. Now I want to make it a little bit more interactive. Right now it is not interactive. It is not taking any input from us, isn't it?
Yes.
So how to make interactive? So what is the purpose of interaction here? It is showing all the details of all the people, but whenever I want to get details of a particular person, I am able to select it. Okay, whenever I select a person, based on my selection, report should display the data, right?
Yes.
So dynamically, I should have a facility to select the employees. And whenever I select the employee ID, ID should be supplied to the report. Based on that ID, report should be generated. Okay. So that is what interaction. Right now, it is purely a static, just reading the data from the database and showing that information into the report. It is directly generating information taken from the report. It's not interactive. It's not taking an input from us. So how do you make this this report interactive? Okay, maybe I want to select one employee name, and whenever I select employee name, I should get his details only, right? So now there comes parameterized reports. Okay, so what do you mean by a parameter? Parameter is a data which is supplied to a program from outside. So depends that will be a input from outside to the program. In the same manner, here we have a parameter section. If we look at this report data, it's left side. We have a parameters category there, and if you add a parameter there, and then whenever you add a parameter to a report, that is called parameterized report. The value for that parameter will be asked by the report whenever you execute it. Let us see that. Now I am adding a parameter. Right click and select add parameter. Now it is asking the name. So give a proper name for the parameter. It may not be the same as the column name, right? Maybe it is a different one. So here I am using employee ID. Okay, and prompt can be a different one. Select or enter employee ID. Let us say enter employee ID. Now, what is the type of this employee ID? Initially, it is showing text. Now, you can go for integer. Okay, so we are given a name, and this is the actual name of the parameter. It should not contain, better not to contain any blank spaces there. And here you can have a prompt that shows that will be shown to you whenever the report is executed, and it may contain spaces, and then select the data type and then click OK. I am not using other options right now, just save this and now try to execute this, try to run this. Whenever this report is ran, immediately it is asking the employee ID. It is not showing anything, it is not displaying any report here, isn't it? So here along with this text box, it is showing the prompt, enter employee ID, whichever the prompt we have given there, and now it is showing one more button at right side, view report. So you type, you have to type the employee ID here and then click on the employee view report here. Whenever you click on that, immediately it is moving forward and it is generating the output. So whatever the output is showing, it doesn't, you don't bother it about it right here, right at this instance. So report will be generated, our observation is report is generated only after clicking on the view report, after providing the value to the parameter. So how do you link up this parameter to this? Right now the report is generating, taking the entire data from the database, but it is not affecting this employee ID which we are giving, is not affecting the report. Now how do you link up this input with your report, right? Whatever the employee ID you are supplying here, whatever the employee ID you are supplying here should be provided as input to the generated data here. For example, where you are generating the data here, take this employee data set, right? So this is bringing the data. If you right click and select data set properties, the query which is responsible for bringing the data, you can see that query here, right? Now to this query you need to supply the data from this employee ID. So whenever you execute a report is taking data from you, and that data which you are inputting will be sent to this parameter employee ID. Now you want to use it here, you have to use it. So how to use it here? Where condition, right? So data should be bring, okay, data should be brought to this report based on the employee ID, right? We should not bring all the data. If you bring only one data or the data which is satisfying the condition based on your report, and that will be shown to in your report, right? So that is why here I am applying where condition, where EMPID, what are the fields here, click on this field, okay, actually so we are getting, see employee ID here, okay, now EMPID is the column name equals to then at symbol employee ID. This is the parameter. So this is the parameter which we have created here. You should be see prefixed with the at symbol, okay. So at symbol followed by this parameter name. Now if you apply this, whichever the input you give to this program, and that will be placed into this query, and query will extract the data based on the condition which you have supplied, and that data will be shown in report. That is so we can make it interactive. So now click OK and now go for preview again. You are running this. Now here one I am giving, click on view report. So it is not showing any data because no employee is there with one employee ID one. So that is why here I am giving 1001. Click on this view report. Now we are getting the data of 1001, right? 1001. So this is how we can prepare interactive. At the runtime, you provide an input to the report, and based upon your input, it will generate the report. So this is called interactive report using the parameterized reports. The technique is parameterized report. So applying parameters to the report, we can make these reports interactive. Okay. So let us see one more. 1002. Now it's not there. 1003. It's also not there. Now how you can know whether the employee is existing or not? We don't know. So we keep on go for trailing, right? And if you know the employee ID, then we can. So what is the best way? Instead of asking the employee ID, if you can display employer name, and if any person display selects a person name, and if the selection sends employee ID, not the employee name, employee ID, then it will be a meaningful way of interaction. We don't know what are the available employee IDs, right? So instead of asking the employee ID using a text box, better we display the available employee names. And whenever I select the employee name, the selection should send employee ID to the query. Now how to change this? Right click this employee ID. Now here available values, default values, it is showing all these, right? Go for available values. Now it is showing none. Go for specify values, then manually you can add all these. Go for browsing this here. See here. I'm selecting start dot. What is the database? AMPDB. Dot dot. TBL. Employee master. So 1000, 1001, 1006 is there, right? Okay. Now, if you look at this process, they are trying to add all these numbers manually, right? What happens if the number of users are increased and some of them are deleted? For example, here manually I am populating all the values. And 100 and the value will be, what is the name of this first person? Krishnamani. 1000 is Krishnamani. So if I so what happens if you delete the Krishnamani from the database using other applications, and now if you are trying to use this report and the report displays as Krishnamani because we have added this information manually, it doesn't look nice, right? It's not a proper way. So what the thing is, we need to generate them taking the data from the table, right? So that's why here come back. Now this data set which is already used to generate the database, sorry, this report, right? So remember, whichever the data set you are using to generate the report should not be used for populating the values into the parameters. That's why you need to create one more data set, add data set. Now here I'm going to use employee names data set, right? Now this time I'm going to use select not star, right? EMPID and only EMP name, two columns from TBL employee master. Now click on OK button. We will be getting all EMPIDs and employer names. So we have got one more data set with employee name and ID. Now let us populate this employee ID with all the information taken from this data set and go for properties of this parameter. There go for available values, and now I'm not going to use none. I'm not going to use specify values. So if you use specify values, we need to add data manually. It's not proper for this example. So I'm going to use third option. Third option is get values from a query, and now you need to select the data set. And employee data set is which is already used for generating the data for the report. That's why we should not use it. And employee names data set. Even now we can use it. Label field is for displaying. So what the thing you need to display? Employee name is to be displayed. And if I select any employee name, value should be sent to the query is employee ID. So that's why employee ID is a value field, and it will be hidden. And label field will be displayed in the drop down, right? So that is why I have selected employee ID as a value field and label field as employee name, right? So now click on this OK button, and okay, one more property we need to set. See here. Right now, if you want to allow multiple values, you can use. We'll do it later, right? So far we have used only available values are populated from this data set. Let us see how this parameter looks. See, whenever you have selected that available values which are multiple, then you will be getting a drop down here, and now you can select the names. If you select the name and click on the view report, ID will be sent to the query, because value field is now is populated with employee IDs, right? Now select Ramana. Click on this view report. Now we are getting the details of Ramana. Kamal. You can select randomly. Now this gives you flexibility in selecting the names without knowing their IDs. But the process requires employee ID. So how we are attaching all these IDs and names? Taking the IDs and names from the another data set here, employee names data set, and we are populating this employee ID parameter with the multiple values, and it is showing a drop down, and from the drop down we are selecting the name and clicking on the web view report, and the ID of that fellow selected in fellow will be sent to the report, and now it will execute that query. See here, the query is this one. So based on your input, it is now extracting the information of only one person. For example, now I want to allow this parameter for taking multiple values. Now you click on this allow multiple values. Now click on OK. Now go for running this. See here, now we are getting check boxes on every option. I am selecting Kamal and Seshwabu. Now if you look at it is multiple selection, and click on view report. Now we are getting an error. So what it is saying is must declare the scalar variable employee ID, it is saying. Why it is saying? Because right now if you look at the input, we are giving two IDs, but actually the data set which is having this query is written only to take one value per time. So because we have used equal to symbol here, then how can you use, for example, if you apply 1001 comma 1006, and syntactically this is wrong query, right? So that is why if you want to use such kind of multiple values, then you can go for list operator, that is in operator, right? Without using equal, instead of using equal to symbol which operates on only one value, but we can use this in operator which operates on multiple values. And see, maybe you are using only one. So in operator is suitable for working with at least one or multiple values, right? So that is why here I am using this parameter inside the brackets. You need to use this bracket. Syntactically you need to use brackets. And if you send multiple values to this employee ID parameter, okay, this query will be very meaningful. Select char from table employee master where employee ID in, and within the brackets whatever the values you have supplied will be placed, and the query will be executed properly. So that is why we have changed this operator from equals to symbol to in operator, and we have enclosed this employee ID parameter within the brackets, function brackets. Now save this and try to execute this report. Now I'm selecting Krishna, Raghava and Kamal, 3 multiple value selection. Now whenever you click on the view report and this selection will bring all the, will take all the employee IDs of those selected people, and 3 employee IDs, EMP IDs will be sent to the query. Let us see the output. Now we are getting the details about those 3 selected Krishnaveni, Raghava and Kamal values, right. Now you select all, if you click on this select all button, it will select all the values available. Now if you click on this view report, we will be getting all the values. So with this illustration, with this demonstration, what we have learned, how to convert, the first point is how to convert or develop is the best word, how to develop interactive reports. Okay, this is the first point we have learned, and the answer is using parameterized reports. So reports with parameters, right, parameterized reports. And second point we have learned is how to supply single values. To report. Okay, the answer is just by enabling parameters, a parameter, right? And without enabling allow multiple values, understand. So initially allow multiple values in the parameter is not enabled, see here initially, but it is enabled now. Allow multiple values are enabled. If you uncheck this one, it will be disabled, it will take only one. Let us see, I am selecting Krishna, this time I am not getting any check boxes, but still it works because we are using in operator, and that will work even with a single value. And then we have understand and how to use multiple, so how to supply multiple values to report just by enabling allow multiple values property on parameter. Okay, these are the points we have learned with this demonstration. And do you have any queries regarding this?
Yeah, Espan, I have one question. So like when we are in the design tab, like we do not see that parameter, right? But whereas when we go to the preview, we are able to see that parameter, like the employee ID and everything. So I mean, like, is
that's
there
part,
a way that we align those the search controls also?
See, I mean, actually, like, for example, I'll tell you the reason why it is not providing much flexibility for aligning all this. See, the preview is a tool. Okay, this Microsoft control is providing this information on the top of the report, right?
Right.
Maybe a developer doesn't need this kind of drop down control. He wants to send, see, for example, you take a website, okay, there you want to build your own interface, right? For example, let us see, in MS Paint I am going to explain. For example, I am having a page in my ASP.NET website, right? Or any PHP or a JSP. This page is having some portion where I'm going to display my drop down controls, my own, right? My own drop down controls, which are very purely HTML. Okay, and text boxes from those, and whenever that fellow selects anything from those text boxes and drop downs and check boxes, okay, check boxes and radio buttons, whenever he submits that information using a submit button, right? Here I am using a button. So whenever I select, so this thinking that this is a drop down and this is a text box and this is a check box and this is a radio button, right? And after selecting all the information from these, if I click on this button thinking that this is a submit button, right? Just below this button, this user interface, I want to display the output, that is report here, right? So I want to display the report here in this area, right?
Right.
So then what is the use of having the drop down controls which are not proper for me? So that is why here this control in SSRS is a helping to the user for checking the report, right?
Right.
Then what to do is here go to parameters, say hidden, right? Click OK, go for preview. Here it will not display anything, but actually it is expecting a employee ID. Okay. Then no need to worry. Still the report is working properly, right? What it is expecting is an employee ID. Now we build and publish this. What other developers do whenever they are preparing any applications, right? They will call this SSRS report from the SSRS server into their applications.
Oh, so that means like we can integrate SSR into like any ASP.NET application?
Yes, not just ASP.NET, man. As I told you, it is.
No, sorry, SSR was not there in the class, so I guess might be that reason.
Okay. It is. Is it Krishna?
Yeah. Right.
Right. So maybe your application is a desktop application, okay? Maybe your application is a web application with a different technology. Maybe your desktop may be prepared using Java or C sharp or VB or C++, any kind of language, right? Or C. And maybe your website is built up with ASP or ASP.NET or JSP. Or PHP, whatever the technology, or CGI. Okay,
right.
All these latest languages, they know HTML, right? If you can give the HTML input, they can display that HTML properly to their users using their interfaces, right?
Right.
In desktop, we call them windows, and in web, we call them pages, right? That is only the difference.
Right.
But as far as these technologies know how to read and display the HTML, which is common, right, in all the current languages, modern languages, your all desktop applications and web applications, if they get HTML as a input to them, so automatically they can display that report properly, right?
Right.
As it is. That is why, based on this concept, SSRS, whatever the file you are preparing here, for example. Employee list dot RDL. This is a report description language. A separate language. This is not a VB, which is not a C sharp, which is not a Java, right? It's a different language. only ASP.NET can understand this. Only SSRS service can understand this. Okay, but actually it is embeddable. This RDL is embeddable in any application. Remotely they can write a program in their application. They can write a program. Okay, I'll show you. So I'll prepare one small application in ASP.NET, and I'll show you how to integrate this SSRS report into client applications. Right?
Sure.
Okay. Then you can easily understand how other people, other developers will are going to use your SSRS reports prepared by you. Right? You should have an idea.
Right.
So that is why the thing is here. This is embeddable. This is callable. Not we can say we can't say embeddable, but it remotely can be called by other applications. So now this application can write a program and can call this remote report and immediately gets the response from the report in terms of HTML, right?
Yeah.
In terms of HTML, immediately whenever it gets the HTML, that application displays that information here directly, right? So that is why the report which is available remotely should be able to accept parameters from the programs, right? Are you following, Krishna?
Yeah, right.
Methods.
Right. Yeah, I got it. So basically that, yeah, right.
So then there we do, those fellows doesn't need our user interface like drop downs and everything, right?
Right.
And they will have their own interface. That is why we prepare parameters and we'll check it and we hide them parameters. Whenever you hide the parameters, parameter will be active, but it will not be visible. The user interface will not be visible here, right? But still works. Still works. So I'll show you in using other report. You can call this report also. Using other report, from other reports you can call this report. There you can see how a parameter can be supplied from outside processes to this report.
Right. Okay.
Okay. Let us understand one more point. I told you every report is a RDL file, right? Report right. Description language file, right? Or report definition language file. Now, whatever the instructions we have here, all those are special instructions, which are known to only SSRS service, isn't it?
Okay.
See, actually, this RDL file will be hosted by your one website, which is called SSRS server, right?
Right. Okay.
So that is why you are going to upload all these RDL files in a website, which is called SSRS report server. As far as that website is running, so what we do with this SSRS service in the program, in the computer. Yesterday I shown you one services.msc in the services list. We have seen reporting services, right? One service is available here.
Right. Yeah.
Okay. Now, if you look at that service, what is the service do actually? So whenever some remote users call this RDL file, this RDL instruction should be executed by one program, right?
Right.
Those instructions are not known to any other applications, right? These instructions
right.
are RDL report definition language instructions. Those instructions are known to only this SSRS service. So that way SSRS service in your computer is nothing but your running environment, running program of your RDL file.
Okay.
Just like your compiler. Understand?
Right.
So your instructions RDL from the report file will be taken and executed, and output will be prepared in HTML. That HTML will be sent back to the requested user.
Okay.
Do you understand the complete cycle?
Yeah. I got it. So like when we host right. the application, it does not have any dependency on the database. So basically as long as it has like that SSRS server, then we are good. right? So that SSRS
yes.
server is nothing
and one
but
more
like
point, one more. Yeah, tell me.
Yeah. So this SSRS, like when we install, like in the when we are installing like a SQL server, like we have to just select the component called as the SSRS, and on that particular server we can install that SSRS, right? Then we are good with installing.
Exactly.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Actually, if you have a SQL server, the all the SSIS and RS and DS comes with the SQL server CD, right? DVD, right?
Right, right, yeah.
And if you install SQL server, and if you want to make a computer SQL server, it doesn't need all these services. What it needs is, what is the needed service to make a computer as a SQL server? Tell me.
As a agent, a SQL agent.
This program,
yeah,
it is called SQL. No, SQL agent is for scheduling the tasks. It's not a mail service.
Okay.
This is a service, right? SQL server, which is called desktop engine, or sorry, database engine, right?
Right. Yep.
Even it is a Oracle service, right? You need to have a service installed in this list. It is called Oracle database engine. So every database which is a client server based database, then it is having an engine which is installed and running in the computer as a service.
Okay.
So what is the difference between an ordinary program and this service kind of program? Service works in background. Okay. And next point is it is a multi-user. By default, every service is multi-user. Okay. So,
yep.
For example, if you connect to my computer, if you start sending SQL queries, and this is the program which is responsible for receiving those queries and passing those queries and executing those queries and giving the result back to you. This is the program which is doing that communication. So if I stop this, what happens? My computer will no longer receive queries from you. Then I can't say that is my computer is a SQL server, right?
Right. Yeah.
So this is the main program. This is the main program which is making my computer as a SQL server. Because my computer is able to receive queries from you because of this program, right? That's why this is called desktop. Sorry, database engine. So, how many database engines are installed here? Three, with different names, right? One is with the name MS SQL Server, which is called default instance, which can be called using my computer name, right? How do you call this? Whenever you're trying to connect to my computer, just you may be giving this computer name, right? My computer name is Windows Server. So while you are connecting to this computer using your Management Studio, then you can use my computer name from you. If you are using a remote computer, then you need to use my computer IP address. Right, if it is having a static IP, you can use it from your computer, or else if your computer is in within my network, then you can use my computer name, Windows Server, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right.
And this database, whenever you are calling SQL Server connecting to my computer, if the my computer is having multiple instances of the database engine, and each database engine is making my computer as a single server, and now if you load three, now my computer behaves like a three database servers. Single computer behaves like a three database servers, right?
Right.
So now if you want to call SQL server, the default SQL server can be contacted using my computer name. And if you want to contact other instances, for example, SharePoint is another instance, and where I have a separate set of databases. Okay, and see, SQL Express is a different database engine, which is making my computer one more database server, right? So if I load SQL Server database engine for 3 times, my computer behaves like a 3 database servers. In each instance, you can have multiple databases. For example, one set of databases can be maintained here, one set of databases can be maintained here, one set of databases can be maintained here, right? So now, how do you contact this SharePoint? A database server in my computer, which is having that SharePoint name, and should be contacted like this: computer name, then instance name. Okay, if you want to use another SQL Express, you contact this one. So each instance we can maintain different databases because each instance behaves like a separate database server, isn't it?
Right. Yeah.
So that is why these programs, what is that program? This program is called database engine, and that is making my computer as a database server, right? Now, generally, how your MSBA tools are developed and MSBA servers are maintained? Just I am using a standalone server. This is called standalone deployment. This is called standalone deployment or standalone MSBA server. That means all the services like database engine. Okay, and SSIS service and SSRS service and SSCS all are installed in one computer, right?
Right.
But if you take multiple computers and if you use one computer for database, another computer for SSIS and SSRS and SSCS separately, it is called multi server MSBI deployment or installation, right? So why do we use these different computers for different services? If you load only SSIS, that becomes SSI server. If you load only SSRS service, it becomes only SSRS server. That serves only reports. Okay. And if you load only SSIS in a computer, that becomes only analysis server. If you have multiple servers for multiple purposes, for different services, performance will be very more, right? You get more performance,
right? Yeah.
So this kind of implementation or deployment is called multi-server MSBI deployment. Our implementation. Okay. So all the packages you deploy in SSIS, okay, all the reports you deploy in SSRS, and all the OLADB, okay, OLAP databases you deploy here, okay, and they can take multiple data from multiple sources, not just for SQL Server, right? Your client may be having one Oracle server, one SAP server, okay, and one Sybase and DB2's databases and SQL Server, and these technologies SSIS, RS and AS, they are able to read data from all the any kind of data sources, right? So that's why these technologies are heterogeneous technologies. They access data from any kind of source. That is why MSBI is so much flexible and popular. Understand?
Yeah, it's fine. That's clear. Yeah.
And now, let us see.
Pavan, one more thing.
Tell me.
Is it like unless and until we run this report, like run any report, in fact, like we get to know, like it is a parameterized report or it is not a parameterized report? Is it like without running a report, then we would not know what is it?
See, every report may not be a parameterized report. That's okay. The first point. Okay, I'm not saying it's a constraint. Okay, sometimes you may want to publish reports which may not be interactive, right?
Right.
So maybe your the client doesn't need all the interactive, right?
Yes.
But Microsoft is providing all these facilities. We are discussing all these facilities because what kind of client we'll get, we don't know, right?
Yeah.
And what are the
my question was like, if unless and until we run the report, we don't know. The parameter whatever we are inputting into the report, we are not able to see that, right? Unless and we go to the preview tab, we would not know a parameter is inbuilt in that.
See, you are so see everything will be documented. Maybe you are not using this. You are not designing this report.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, but whenever some people wants to send some say something like I have these reports, okay, they take these parameters. Now you prepare another report based on this existing reports. Then they have to send all the information required for you, right? They'll give you all the details documentally. So they'll provide a document to you saying that this this is a report and this report has these parameters and this accepts single parameter or multiple parameters. Everything will be explained to you through a document.
Okay, so under the solution explorer, just by looking at the RDL file, we will not know if it is a parameterized report or not, right?
Yes, but actually, whenever you open this report, at the right left side, maybe it is not developed by you, but if you get this RDL file and if you add it to your report project, and if you open that file immediately along with that this design and preview left side, you are getting a report data panel. There you can find this parameter section, right? There you can find easily, you can find these parameters. Whenever you find some parameters, you can think this is a parameterized report, right? Right. So now see here final single value and then how to enable multiple values. This is the option to make available of multiple values. Right. Okay. Let us see one more. So after completion of this, let us move to the another project, sales report project. Right. Now, if you look at this data, now this data is having sales table, right? Isn't it? And in this table I have sales, right? Now I want to have sales, I want to display sales. So how do you display sales? TBL sales, I am getting the sales, right? Now along with the sales, see here receipt number, all this product 1, 2, all these. So product by sales I want to get and should be grouped by products. So order by product ID. If you want to bring all the product related information together, so you can order by this. So these are the details of all the products, right? Okay, now I want to build a query. See here, actually my purpose is I want to prepare a report. Listen carefully, I want to prepare a report that displays information of sales, right? Okay, let us build this first. First of all, add new data source, so which is a shared one. So sales data source, now is which is a SQL server, or you can select any kind of server, then you can click on the edit button. So it helps you in building that connection string. Now I want to use my local computer. And authentication is Windows authentication, and I want to use sales database. And test connection is succeeded. Now click on OK. Now you can find this is a string, connection string. Then click on this. And now RDS report data source file is ready. And now click on this add new item, select a report. Now this is sales, right? Sales report. Sales report dot RDL is the report we are going to design. So initially I want to create a data source for local purpose, right? Always remember, as I told you, maybe you are using a shared data source. Every data report needs a local data source which may be connected to this shared data source, right? So this is the local data source, right? Sales DS, for showing the difference between that shared data source and the local data source, I am giving the different names. So sales DS is the local data source. Now I am not going to connect it directly, I want to take it directly from the shared source and take this data source, shared source, click OK. Now right click this connection and then select add data source, data set. Now what is the data set? Data set is an object that brings the data from the given data source, right? So now what we are getting here, sales data, sales data set using this local data source which is connected to the central, that is shared data source. And query designer, click on this query designer and click on this button which is now enabled. Disable this button by clicking on that. So immediately it allows us to build the query not by writing, just by using this user interface. So here actually it is giving all the sales. Now you can select all the columns or individual, whichever not required you can leave them. Okay, so after selecting these columns you can define sorting on this. Actually you can write this query yourself and you can use it. Okay, for more complex queries you can use these user interface. Now click on this exclamation button, you will be getting the sample data here and that shows the query is built properly. Now click OK. Now you can find this query here, right? So if you click on this fields and you can find all the fields are brought into this query properly. Now click on OK. So now you can find all the fields are coming here, right? Let us build a report that displays the sales details. Okay, and here go to toolbox and I am not going to insert any header and footer, we will do it later. So our primary motto is to build the and see how the sales data can be displayed here. I am taking the table here. Whenever you place it, so automatically whichever the data set you have created will be connected to this. And here I am adding receipt number, product ID, unit price. And now you can add columns, quantity and discount and line total. Now you can expand this report area okay, and then you can add one more column. That is for date, transaction date. So actually you can say this is transaction date. On the header you can write transaction date and it can be resized, the cell can be resized to fit that content. And we can change the alignment of these values and quantity, unit price and discount. You can hold shift key, you can hold shift key and you can click on all those, then that is how we can select multiple cells okay. And make them right aligned, right aligned. Okay, and then you select this the first header row, and that can be aligned centrally. And we have enabled bold, and we are just giving a different color and character colors white. Now this is your report, right? Now just execute this report. It brings all the data and shows it, right? But we don't know the product name, what exactly the product is, and showing just the product ID, it doesn't makes doesn't give you a proper sense of what is GDS, right? So that's why product ID, instead of product ID, I want to get product name. So what do you suggest? Do we go for join queries? Do we need to generate a join, or do we need to go for any alternative? Join consumes more, it's less performed, right? Whatever thing is, we need to get only one thing, right? For each row we want to generate only one. So take it as a thumb rule, whenever you require only one item from other table, don't go for join. Okay, if you want multiple values, then we go for join. For each row I want to generate, take one value from other table, that's why you go for subqueries. Here you write a subquery and then give a name, product name, right? So we need to extract product name from TBL master. So how do you write this product name? Select product name from this master products. And actually we need to get only one value here, so it should be scalar. That's why outside table I am giving alias TS, table sales, right? TS, and this is table products, it's a TP. So what is the criteria here? With the value which is coming from the TS, what is the value? Product ID, right? Should be matched with this TP. So where TP dot product ID should be matched from with what is the data coming from the row of sales table, right? Product ID. So this will produce product names for each and every product here. Okay. Now take this query, copy this query, and go to this data set, right click this data set and select the properties and replace this query and click on OK. Now we will get the same except that along with that. So I am inserting one more column, and for this I am using product name. You can, if you want, you can increase the size of this table along with the report size. Now you can run this. Now here I am getting product ID as well as its product name, right? Okay. Now I want to change the order. Now you just delete this from here, product ID, then product name, then I want to include a column here. Insert a column from left into left, and here I want to display the receipt number. So why I am placing receipt number here? Because I want to display the information grouped by the product name, right, and number. So here I am getting multiple entries here, but actually I want to display summary here initially. So I am going to say grouping, right? I am going to group this data based on the product ID. So under one product ID I want to display all the available sales, right? That is the aim of the grouping, right? Now here click on this product ID, right click here, and just say add group, okay, or you can go for row grouping, right? See here. So you can group the information column wise or row wise, but actually here I want to go for row wise grouping, right? I want to group the rows based on the product ID, that's why it is a row grouping. So that's a parent group, you can say it's a parent group. Now it is saying group by, now you select item, so based on which you want to select grouping, product ID wise, okay. Add a group header, add a footer, group for footer, just go for add group header. So now immediately you will get this, right? Or if you don't enable any group header, you it will be placed right at the at just before this column. See here, parent group based on product ID, click OK. So automatically in the same level you will be getting this without adding one more column. So now you can delete this product ID because we will be getting the product ID in the grouping column. See here, preview, go to preview. Now this group is having the product ID, and what are the rows coming under that group based on that product ID is coming under this. Single cell will be mapped with all the other, right? So then no need to display this product ID, and is now group, change the group name to product ID, let us say product ID. Now here we don't need this, delete this column. Now go for preview. Now this is a meaningful presentation, and under product ID 1, product name is all these, and then receipt numbers, these are the receipts and these are the unit prices and all these details, line totals, everything, right? And now, so why we have to display these product name multiple times? That is what is the best way to display the product information here. So instead of product name, and right here in product ID cell, I want to display this information, both product ID and product name. So that's why right click and select expression, is already having an expression, and just you want to, we want to have one more, that is ampersand, okay, give a colon, and some otherwise we can say bracket, and then ampersand, and then the field. So apply fields is the keyword that brings all the fields into your expression. So fields, exclamation symbol, so product name dot value is a property. So if you use this, let us see how the expression shows information. So after product ID it is showing one bracket which is concatenated to the value of the product ID, then product name will be displayed here. And if you want, you can expand this product, now it is not product ID, now simply you can say product. Now see for preview, so here product information is displayed along with the product ID, and then receipt numbers of that product are displayed, okay. And if you think some people may get confused with this 1, 2, 3, they may be thinking these are the serial numbers. Instead of that, you can, what you can do is within the brackets of after product name, you can display them within the brackets. So that's why how to change the expression now. So now you want to get product name first, then concatenated, okay. Now you have to concatenate one more bracket like this. So after product name you will get a bracket symbol, open bracket, then a value will be placed, and then the closing bracket will be placed. So we can say inside ID hash symbol, so immediately the number will be displayed in a proper way. See here, casual shirt within brackets ID number 1. So, like this. Okay. Now, one more I want to do. In each group, how much total line total, right? Line total is the total amount from that purchase, right? And I want to display the summation of summary of all these. So at the end of casual sets section, I want to get summary in how many receipts and total unit price. I am saying how many receipts, not total the receipt numbers. And nobody wants this total of the receipt numbers. I want to know how many receipts we have, right? So that's why. So for creating summary, click on this group, right click, or else you can click on this entire row and click on this, right click on this and select. See here, insert row, okay, inside group, outside group. See, if you select outside, outside applies to the entire table. Remember this, to the entire table. If you want to get summary of the entire table, then you can go for outside. But if you want to get group wise inside the table, so select the inside table. So product wise you will get grouping, but as in total and for the entire table, if you want to apply the grouping, then you can go for outside group. So outside is meant for entire table, inside is meant for grouping of a particular set of rows. So now, where do you want to place the group summary information? Above the row, above the details, and below the details. Some people want to display the details, the summary above the details, and some people they want to display at the bottom of the details. So now I am clicking on the below. So immediately you can find a row is displayed here. Now here click on this any one of the, for example, this is corresponding for the unit price, select this. So what is the expression? See here, it is giving sum of the field name, right? Field and sum. So it's the aggregation function. Aggregation. See here, you can find some help how to find the different functions here. Aggregate functions are average, count distinct, all these, right? Now in the same manner, I want to get the number of receipts. If I select receipt number, because it's a number, summation will be generated. See here, but I don't need summation, right? So nobody wants summation of this. See here, a last row is inserted by adding up all these numbers and by adding up all these unit prices. So for unit price, summation is proper, right? It's a meaningful one. But receipt numbers, I don't want the summation of the receipt number. Nobody wants it. And we need is number of receipts. How many receipts we have generated for this product? 1, 2, 3, 4 receipts. So I want count of the rows, right? So then right click here, go for expression. For expression, not properties, expression. And instead of sum, you can go for count. So you want aggregation function, now you can click on this count. Just select and see the examples here. Okay, now just use count. Click OK. Now for understanding this row separately, you click on this row, any fill in the row, and click on this entire row and give a separate background color for this row. Let us say yellow color. Now save this and go for preview. Now see, end of each group, at the bottom of each group, we are getting this summarization, right? Summary. So now this time it is not displaying 14, it is displaying 4, the count. It is not adding up all these values. But here it is showing the sum, right? And now like that, you can provide information to other columns how to display. See, no need to place a summation for a summary for all the columns. Whenever you need it, you can. So you want to know how many products you have sold, then you can go for summation of quantity. So this gives you the number of items you have sold, and discount, how much you discount, total discounts you have given, that is nothing but summation. And the total line total is nothing but total of all the values in this column. And transaction date, we don't require any summation or summary on this, right? So here save and go and execute. And while you are execute on this, you can find you are getting different kinds of formats, all these here, four zeros are coming here. And in order to make it only two zeros, limited to two zeros, then you need to go for applying formatting. So take any, see, for this unit price and discount line total, we need the same format, right? But quantity is not having any number, floating point. That's why no need to apply that. So if I have selected by holding shift key and clicking on this cell, so I have selected multiple items and going for format and apply the format. So remember, yesterday we have seen the formatting for date. Okay, now we are going to see how to format number using hash symbols and zeros. We can specify the format. For example, if I say 000.00, this indicates if the input value is 1, for example 1, so 1 will be displayed like this, 001.00. And if the input is 1.3, if the input is 1.3, and it will display like 1.30. So always it makes the decimals 2, right? 2 decimals, and it pads all the places which are not having numbers. And what happens to the number which is having more digits in integer place? For example, 1000, or 10,000, or 12,345. So this is the input. And 346.346. Then this will be displayed like this. So don't think it will cut the values. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.3435. It will cut the decimal place and rounds that information up to 2 decimals, and then it will be displayed. And now here whatever the number we are specifying, the digits, number of digits we are specifying, it's for not the maximum value, it is for minimum value, right? Minimum number of digits. So maybe this integer is getting more and more digits, it will be displayed without cutting the numbers. But for decimals, purely that is the number of maximum number of digits, and you should not exceed this number of digits. That's why the remaining number will be rounded up, and then that will be displayed according to your. So if you don't want to use this padding of the numbers, then we can go for hash symbols. Hash symbol does not pad the position which is not having any digit with zero, right? So it doesn't pad. So that's why here, if you see ##.00 is the best way. Or if you say #, if you give 1, so immediately you will be getting in the output, you will be getting only 1, and it will not pad anything. It will not show even a decimal place because you have given hash symbol. And now if you say like this 0#, then 1.0 will be shown to you. And if you say #0 at the end, that means you are forcing to have the 2 digits compulsory. That's why 1.00 will be displayed. So that's why left side 0 always, right side, right extreme 0 at the right side extreme right position forces the number of digits to, right, to have a maximum numbers. For example, here if you have a 0, I've selected this one, this format, and the input is 0. What happens here? zero cannot be given, only it shows blank, everything is blank. Okay, and if you use zero here, and how it will be displayed, 0.0 will be displayed. So integer actually it is zero, that is why zero will not be shown by this hash. And what is the best way of displaying it? Best format is C. At least you should have a zero at extreme right position in both, and then you will get 0.0 here, 0.00, right? This is the format. So that's why have a zero, at least one zero at the extreme right position, and at the extreme right position of integer and decimal places. And one more thing you can do is you can specify commas, placeholders, right? Comma separators. Now immediately commas will be used according to your input. For example, you take this input, this input, and here if we, if this is the input of this for this format, and so here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.35 will be displayed. Okay, comma after 3 digits, and then if it is having one more digit here and one more comma will be shown to you. Okay, this is how we can format numbers. And now I am taking this format, okay, and adding it to this format. If commas are not needed, ignore them. See here, if you include commas, we are getting this, these commas here, right? But we have applied commas, this formatting, to only the summary row. And now what about this other row? And one more point we need to see here, unit price, discount, line total. For this also we can use, hold the control key. If you want to take a gap between any selection, then you need to hold control. If you use shift, it will collect all the collections between two different selections, right? That's why if you want to ignore one cell in between different selections, hold control key while you are clicking on the cells. Now you apply the same format here. Okay, now output is proper. Now we are getting the totals for this each and every group. Now what about the totals for the entire table? For the entire table I want to get total. Now here select this last row, right click and insert row below, right, outside group below. If you click on the outside group below, a row will be added to the entire table. Now here you can find, if I add receipt number, okay, select this expression and make it count, change it to the count. And now change the background color of this, okay, this purple color, and four color is white. And if you want, you can make it bold. Okay, buffer preview. See here, it is saying 11, so excluding that group wise summary lines. Count this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So total number of rows. So this gives you the total summary for the entire table. For the entire table. So you can apply the same unit price. You have to define how much unit price total for the entire table, and discount. Okay, quantity. So all these can be applied here. So if you want, you can apply formatting. Hold the control button and click on this and then apply format. Then you will get proper output that displays information about table wise summary. Okay. So here if you want to display number of receipts, 4 receipts, 11 receipts like that, just change this expression for this receipt count. So concatenate with some receipts, word receipts. And then you add this word even with this class. Right? So 4 receipts here, 1 receipt here, 3 receipts and 11. 11 total receipts. Okay, so that's how we can build this. You can put a bracket here for S saying that even for work it will be a meaningful one. So like this we have enabled this, and somebody wants to know only summary unless until they want the detailed information. So now here also you can make this interactive. Hello, are you there people?
Yes.
Right. So some people want to know only summary unless they want to have the detailed information. They want to ask detailed information. So that is why. So this the first row is actually the details row. I want to hide it, right? Select this enter row, select this row visibility and hide it. Click OK. Now go for preview. Now this time it is showing only the product names and the summary of all these. Okay. And the row is hidden now. Details row is hidden, right? But if I want to know what are the details, it is saying 4 receipts. I want to know the details of those 4 receipts, right? Then here, see here, this row is now hidden. Okay, this row is now hidden. Now you can enable this option, display can be toggled by this report item, and select the group name. Okay, but here group 1 is the actual name, but if you don't want to use that group 1 name, so what is the group actually we have created here? This is the group, right? Click on this cell. Now if you see, group 1 is the name of that cell, and see you can say product info or product group, just meaningful name which is known to us, right? Product group, I am giving a proper name. So now this cell has been renamed, and now if you click on this row which is hidden, this is a details row, right click here and select row visibility. Now it is hidden. Now if enable this option, display can be toggled by this report item, and select the product group. So where is product group? Product group, right? Clicking on this. So product group is a cell name. Now you just go for preview. There you can find a plus symbol. Okay. Here a plus icon. If you click on that, automatically it expands all the details. Isn't it? See how simple it is? If you practice 2 or 3 times, you can easily understand this procedure. Okay, you can collapse that information which whenever you don't need all the details, and you can expand the information from the group cell. So now group cell is toggling. See, there is this group selling is visible in other rows. That's why we have selected this one. And this group cell is toggling the hidden property of this visibility of this these details rows, isn't it? Let us have a look at how we have done this. And what we have done is this group is group cell is available for details rows as well as summary group wise summary row. So now we have clicked on this entire details row. We have selected the entire details row by clicking on the row selector. Right click here and go. We gone for so we went for row visibility and then we have hidden this. We have selected a hide option here to make this visibility property hide, and then we have enabled this display toggle, and now we have declared the toggle cell is product group. So product group is the item on which we are going to display plus symbol. So click OK. And why we have selected this product group? Because this cell is available to all these rows, these two rows, right? That's why we are going to hide this details row. Still, this product group column or cell is visible for the summary row. We are not hiding the summary, right? That is why we are selecting this, which is visible even after hidden this details row. So once you enable this kind of toggling, so then a plus expansion collapsion symbols will be placed in that place. So here, yes. Now here, if you click on this, initially somebody wants to display the information initially with all expanded, right? Now initially, what it is displaying is. It is displaying the information as it is, but it is hiding all the rows, so not detailed information. So initially it is giving only summarization, but somebody wants to have another kind of this presentation. Whenever we display the report, all details should be in a expanded position, right? So that is why here, now how do you change the behavior? See here, initial toggle state is false, that is why it is showing all the information collapsed. If you make this initial toggle state true, see what happens. True, toggle state is enabled here, right? But it is not showing this all the information. That is why you need to reverse this. Right, you need to reverse this. Initially row visibility should be shown, then you can make it hidden toggle. So initially it will be shown and along with the reverse toggle, this is called reverse toggle. So everything will be expanded because all the information is shown, but the toggle state initially it is showing is minus symbol, means expanded. Now you can collapse all this. This is called reverse toggle. Okay, so that is how we can manipulate and all the reports, and we can design the reports, and we can display the reports in more interactive form. So that is why this is also interactive, but this is called drill down. Drill down. Initially we are getting summary and then we are expanding and collapsing it. This is called drill down report. So that is all for today. Keep practicing. If you have any queries, ask me now. Hello.
Yeah, I'm good.
Any queries?
No point. No question from my side.
Radha? Right. Keep practicing. Tomorrow we'll be joining the class at 8 a.m. IST. Because the previous session. I'm not going to do that.